and God's will toward our lives and the goodness of God. And Ephesians chapter 1, I'm going to read verse number 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Now, the part that I want to talk about this evening is the last part of that verse, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Now, if you've been here for the last couple, 3 weeks, you'll hear several things in that verse that we've touched upon. But tonight, I want to look at the who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Who hath blessed us? And I've talked about that hath and the TH in the Bible. We understand that's a continuous thing. And it can be looked at as past tense, but it is primarily continuous. So it says that God hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. God hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Now I'm going to take a little bit of time tonight and kind of teach us what that's talking about. Teach us what that means to our lives and how to apply that to our lives. Who hath blessed us? Now, a lot of times people may say, boy, I wish God would bless me. And I got news for you. He has. Amen. He has blessed you with all spiritual blessings. Now, you may not be seeing the fruit of that in your life today. You may not be seeing the manifestation of that in your life today. But the Word of God says He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus, doesn't it? And I use the example, you know, it would be silly of me to ask Rachel to marry me, wouldn't it? Wouldn't that be goofy? If I just went to Rachel and I said, Rachel, will you marry me? That would be kind of goofy, wouldn't it? Everybody says, of course that would be goofy. Why? Because we're already married. So I wouldn't ask my wife to marry me, would I? So sometimes that's like a believer asking God to bless her. It already says here, He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. So God's part is done. God's side is done. He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. What we need to understand is how to receive those blessings. What we need to understand is how to walk in those blessings. But beloved, I want to tell you right up front tonight, God wants to bless your life. Matter of fact, God has blessed your life. God wants to pour His blessings out on your life. God already has poured His blessings out upon your life. And it's God's will and God's desire for each and every one of us to walk in His blessings. He's already blessed us with all spiritual blessings. It's already been given. Amen?
Amen.
You with me so far?
Yes.
I mean, we've got to understand this because one of the things that a lot of people have done is we've got ourselves in this religious trap where we're always trying to earn things from God. I'm always trying to do better, and then I'll get something from God. I'm trying to work harder, and I'll get something from God. I'm trying to live better, and I'll get something from God. I'm trying to do this, and I'll get something from God. If I was just a better person, I would receive something from God. But it says there, He's already blessed us with all spiritual blessings. You see, one of the things that I want to do tonight, and hopefully, is we can shift gears a little bit and get our mindset to where we're not thinking, how do I earn something from God? Get our mindset, well, how do I receive something? There's a lot of difference in that. And I don't know, I know I use this example too when I talk about this, but I don't know if you guys have been in there, and this is again not a question for you to necessarily answer, but have been in a relationship where you felt like you was always trying to have to earn somebody's approval. Trying to always do better, try harder, do better, because if you didn't, that person wasn't going to be pleased with you. And I don't know what your experience has been, but I found that to be a very, very miserable experience in life. If you're in a relationship with somebody and you're always trying to please them, that's awful. That's an awful situation. But a lot of people, beloved, that's how their walk with God is. They're always trying to please God and always trying to earn something from God and always hoping God's going to love them and always hoping God's going to bless them. But it says there that He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings. So we don't have to earn God's blessings. We have to receive God's blessings. There's a difference, isn't there? We don't have to earn God's blessings. We have to receive God's blessings. And we're going to look at several different scriptures tonight to help us understand what I'm talking about there. But it goes, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Now here's the key words right here, in Christ. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ. In Christ. Now, one of the things we got to understand throughout the scriptures is in Christ. And I always go back to the example, and most of us remember Cain and Abel. And Cain and Abel were the two sons, and they came, and Cain had an offering, and Abel had an offering. And Cain gave his offering, and God rejected it. And Abel brought forth his offering, and God respected it and received it. And you might say, well, what did God have against Cain? You might say, what did God have against Abel? What was the case about that? But we understand the Word of God teaches us that Cain's offering was something that he wanted to bring forth. It's just what he cooked up, what he decided, what he devised to bring forth. Abel brought forth an offering as it was directed by God that represented Jesus Christ. And so that represented offering that Abel brought that was received by God was representative of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so God received that. The offering that Cain brought was representative of Cain's work and Cain's efforts, and it was rejected by God. Beloved, there's only one offering that the Father will receive, and that's the offering of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And everything that we ever receive from God is on the basis of what Jesus Christ has done for us. He has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. In Christ. That's the two key words to understand in that verse. I am blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ. You are blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ. Everything you need to in your life, every blessing you will need in your life is already yours in Christ. Everything a person needs for their life to be restored is already theirs in Christ. But we need to know how to walk and receive it, not how to earn it. Cain was trying to earn something from God. Abel was receiving something from God. Cain brought forth something that represented his works and his efforts and his deed. Abel brought forth something that represented the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. One was looking to receive, the other was looking to earn. You know, we got to go back here to understand what this scripture is telling us and understand the problem. We're back in the Garden of Eden. Most of us are familiar with that account. That God told them that, well, Adam and Eve, if they ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, says in the day that you eat from that, what's going to happen? You're going to surely die. And so we know what transpired, that Eve cut from the tree of knowledge of good and evil and ate, and she shared with Adam. Adam jumped right on board. And as a result of that, they died. Now, the thing we have to understand, they didn't fall over dead, did they? They were physically alive. They were walking around biologically alive. But the Bible teaches us that they were spiritually dead. Something happened at that point in time. They suffered separation from God. Now, that's key to understanding the blessings of God. We have to understand the problem. And the problem came from spiritual death or separation from God. As a matter of fact, look at Ephesians chapter 2 real quick. Look at verse 1. Says that you have he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. He's telling those at the church in Ephesus that they were made alive and they were already once dead in trespasses and sins. They were in a state of death until a person is born again, they are spiritually dead. When the prodigal son, when they talked about the prodigal son, when he came home, the father says, you were once lost, but now you're found. And so we understand it. You were once dead, but now you are alive. And so when he was wandering off and straying off and separated from the Father, he was seen as being dead. But when he returned to the Father, he was perceived as being alive. What was he talking about? Spiritual death. That's when we're separated from God, we're in a state of spiritual death. And if you don't understand this, there's all kinds of things in the Bible sometimes that just won't make a lot of sense. I mean, there was a time that a person was going to follow Jesus, and he says, well, wait a second, let me first go bury my father. And Jesus just responded and said, let the dead bury the dead. What was he talking about? Let the spiritually dead take care of the spiritually dead. You and I got work to be done that only the people who are spiritually alive can do. So Jesus was recognizing something there. The Word of God refers to that over and over and over about us being alienated from the life of God, about us being separated from God. So the reason I'm going into all this and laying all of this out is because if we understand in Christ, separation from God. That's where it began. And that's where all the problems came from, was the end result of death coming upon this planet, spiritual death coming upon this planet, so to speak, because mankind and God was separated. People always look at the planet and say, well, God's such a loving God, why is this world in such a mess? Newsflash, because this world's in rebellion to God. If they were walking with Him in relationship with Him, the world would be a beautiful place. But since they decided to rebel against Him and sin and be separated from Him, then they reap the consequences. All of the problems in our life have come as a result of separation from God. The reason I'm pounding on that, because if all the problems come as a result of separation from God, then all of the problems can be eventually solved by being in relationship with God. If the problem is separation, the answer is relationship. You follow me on that so far? That's important to understand. See, when Abel brought forth his offering, he was offering the only means by which mankind can be in relationship with God. That's why they understood that, and that was, they began to get revelation of that and understanding that very early, clear back then, of the lamb and the offerings and the sacrifices. And that's why when John the Baptist looked at Jesus, he pointed at him and said, there's the lamb slain. There's the lamb. They understood. They were anticipating the lamb. They understood what the sacrifices represented. They understood what the offerings represented. They understood the Lamb of God, Jesus. He was referred to that in the book of Isaiah chapter 53. The Lamb that was slain for our sins. And Christ. All that God had, all the blessings that God had for our lives was lost as a result of mankind being separated. All the blessings are restored as a result of mankind coming into relationship. You remember the prodigal son? I just brought him up a little bit earlier. When the prodigal son wandered off and did his thing, right his living and lost everything and spent his inheritance, and he came to his senses and he came back to his father. When he came back to his father, he got restored completely into all the blessings of being a son. He wasn't received as a second-hand citizen. He was received as a son. And all the blessings that go with being a son were then his. You see, the Bible tells us that we are joint heirs with Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen? Amen? You with me so far? We're going somewhere with this tonight. You see, all through the Bible, we see that taught us. Exodus chapter 12. In Exodus chapter 12, we know that they put the blood above the door, the death angel passed over. And whoever had the blood above the door, the death angel couldn't take the life, correct? Right. What was that blood representative of? Jesus. That blood was representative of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That blood represented Jesus. And we go all through the Bibles and we find all kinds of types and examples of representing Christ and Him crucified, or as we're looking at tonight, in Christ. In the time when the people were grumbling and complaining and they got bit by the snakes and Moses cried out to God, God told him to take a pole and put a serpent on the top of it and hold it up. And everybody who looks at that pole, everybody who looks at that serpent will be healed. And then Jesus explained to us later on in John chapter 3, that serpent on the pole was Him upon the cross. We know that the same Israelites were grumbling and complaining again because they were thirsty and needed water. Moses again went to God and said, what do I do? And God told Moses, go tap the rock. And when you tap the rock, enough water is going to flow out of there for everybody to drink and all the animals to drink. And he did what? He went and tapped the rock twice. And because he tapped the rock twice, he couldn't go into the promised land. That seems harsh, but Christ was to be smitten one time, not twice. That rock, we find out later, was Jesus. What's all of these scriptures pointing to, beloved? Exactly what I'm trying to tell you, that once we enter into relationship, that in Christ is all these spiritual blessings. In Christ there's salvation. In Christ there's healing. In Christ there's living water. In Christ there's provision. In Christ there's restoration. In Christ there's any blessing that any of us would ever need. The all spiritual blessings belong to us in Christ. So we don't earn it. He's already done it. We receive it. Hallelujah. We don't earn it. We receive it. Go to Romans chapter 8. to. I've always loved the scripture. I remember the first day many years ago when I read this scripture and it really hit me when I was saved. How it has exploded inside of me. This one verse just totally changed my life and my understanding of God. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Now let's read that again. He that spared not his own son, that's Jesus, right? But delivered him up for all us all. In other words, he gave him all of us. He died on the cross, paid the price, buried, resurrected, sent him on the right hand of the Father. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? How are those things given? Freely. That's a big word there, isn't it? What do you have to do to earn something that's given to you freely? How much does it cost for you to receive something that's given to you freely? Does not say there that in Christ, God gives us all things freely. Does it say that? It does, doesn't it? Freely gives us all things. He hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. In Christ, he freely gives us all things. Now, if I was you guys, I'd go, whew. You can kick off the workload. You don't have to earn it. That's a blessing. And I've shared it before. There was a time in my life and in my walk with the Lord where I got so miserable because I was trying so hard to earn things from God. And I was trying so hard to live right for God and do this for God. And it just made my life miserable because I was under the law. And then I had a revelation that, you know what, somebody invited me and says, why don't you just learn to enjoy your walk with God? Why don't you just learn to enjoy your relationship with God? And one of the things that has helped me so much to do that is realizing these basic truths. I don't have to jump through hoops to earn things from God. I personally don't like to jump through hoops. I don't know if you guys do or not, but I've been in relationship with people where I had to jump through hoops. I've had jobs where I had to jump through hoops. I've dealt with people where I had to jump through hoops. I'm glad when I approach God, I don't have to jump through hoops. Here's what you got to do, Mike. Here's the trick you got to do. Okay, Mike, 50 push-ups, 50 jumping jacks, and then run and jump through that hoop, and you can have a blessing. But beloved, some people think that's how it is with God. They think God's going to have you do certain tricks. God's going to have you do certain deeds. God's going to have you do this, this, and this. And they spend their whole time walking with God, trying to earn things from God and make themselves miserable all the time. It says here that God in Christ has freely given us all things. So if I go to God and ask for something, I've freely been given it, haven't I? You see, we've got to understand that. Because if we don't, when we approach God, we're not going to approach him with the proper faith. If I approach God with the mentality that I've got to earn something from God, then when I go to him and ask him for something, I'm going to be thinking, well, I don't know if I've done enough good to earn that one. I don't know if I have enough God stamps to get that one. I mean, come on! But I don't have to approach him that way. I approach him knowing that in Christ Jesus, he has blessed me with all spiritual blessings. It's not a matter of who I am. It's not a matter of who you are. It's a matter of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done to purchase those blessings for you and I. But we've got to get that idea out of our heads that we're trying to earn stuff. You remember the parable I always use, the example with the Pharisee and the tax collector? And they're in prayer, and the Pharisee's always patting himself on the back and talking how wonderful he is. Well, I thank God I'm not like all the other people. I thank God that I pay my tithes, I pray, I fast, I do this, I do that. All these things, this big list of stuff that he does. And the other ones over there praying, saying, God, have mercy on me. And won't even lift his eyes up to heaven. And it's said by the language here, I've explained it before, he's appealing to the mercy seat. The mercy seat's where the blood was put, where God says, I'll meet you. But Jesus says, which one of those do you think is justified? Obviously, the one who's putting his faith in the shed blood of Jesus, not the one who's putting his faith in his good works. are his good deeds. You see, that don't we think, well, that's just about salvation. That's everything. If you think you're going to go to God and receive something because of your good works or good deeds, I've got news for you. God's ears are going to be closed. But if you go to him on the basis of what Jesus Christ has done,
amen,
his ears are always going to be open. You see, what I'm describing is faith, isn't it? That's why we receive everything we receive from God by faith, because Jesus has already purchased it. I don't have to earn it. It's already paid for. I just use my faith to make a withdrawal. Hallelujah.
I mean, you got to try to earn some if you want. Everything's being earned some. I see Tim in the picture in my spirit of a little hamster running with wheels. And sometimes that's how people serve God. They just that little hamster in their arm. I'm not going to please God. I'm going to God have. God's saying, you know what? I've already blessed you with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. With him, all things. Now let's think about this in line with our prayer life. Now, go to Matthew chapter 21. A lot of people have problems with this. It's something about this is the area where the Bible tells us that we're transformed by the renewing of our mind, and this is one of the things that we need to really renew our mind on. We have a hard time sometimes asking God for things. So we think, well, I'll just ask God for just a little bit. I mean, I know God loves me, and I know God's truth, and I don't want to ask for too much. I'm just going to ask for a little bitty blessing. And maybe you think, well, that sounds silly, but we think that way a lot, don't we? I know, because I have people come to me and Pastor, will you pray about this and pray about that? I don't want to ask all of that. You know, it's like a pastor came to me one time and dealt with a mission field need and said, will you pray for this mission field need? And we need, like, you know, $100 to get by for another week. And, well, how much would it cost to pay the whole bill? Oh, I don't know, so much. Well, how long would it take God to save $100,000? How long would it take God to raise $100,000? Is that in all things? You see, sometimes our faith is too small because we're thinking along the line that I have to earn this from God. I haven't done enough good yet to deserve to ask for that kind of blessing. I mean, I've been young in the Lord. I've been doing a few things. I'm just a little blessing person. And, you know, along the way, I really screwed up a few times. I did this and I did that. So I went back to go. Like we're playing spiritual monopoly. But when it comes to our prayer life, let me read, share a scripture, Matthew 21, verse 22. And when you connect the two things, suddenly it makes more sense. Because if you just read this verse sometimes, just all by itself without connecting it with what I'm teaching, sometimes it's hard to understand. Sometimes the promises that Jesus gave us about prayer seem too big. And all things, Matthew 21:22, whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. All things. What right do I have to ask for all things? Well, because in Christ, I've already been given all things. So if I've freely been given all things, then I have a right or a privilege to ask for all things. Correct? And if I've been given all things, then apparently God wanted me to be blessed with all blessings. So apparently you and I have the right to go to the Father in prayer in the name of Jesus and ask for all things. Right? There's nothing I could ask for within God. Plan and design and purpose and will that hasn't been purchased already by Christ. Now notice what it says there. Whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, start taking a poll on that, and I'm going to start asking people that. Do you believe God's going to answer this prayer? Well, why do you believe that?
Because he hears us.
Because?
Our heart and our soul.
What does the word say? Because he has freely given me all things because of what Jesus has done, right? So if Jesus has paid the price for me to receive all things, then I have the right to go to him in the name of Jesus to ask for all things and to believe that I will receive them because they've been freely given to me by the works of Jesus Christ. All things in Christ. In Christ. Now, look at this. Go back to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Freely. That's a big word there, freely. You know, it's amazing. And a while back, I did a study there. And I was really surprised how often the Bible talks about God freely giving us things. I mean, that's one of those words that you don't necessarily notice when you read the Bible. You read right over there, and he says, freely given us all things. We don't stop and think, what's he saying there? But there's a lot of places where it's mentioned that God has freely given things to us. What does freely given mean? It means we've received a gift. It means we've received something. It's been freely given to us. And Sue brought some cups and gave gifts away at church this morning. She gave them freely. There's no conditions, no charge. She didn't send us a bill in the mail. At least I don't think so. And so they were freely given. The Bible says we are justified freely by his grace. So when I came to Christ when I was 25 years old, and after my 13 years of drug and alcohol addiction and all the crazy stuff I did, I got down on my knees, I asked Jesus to be my Lord and Savior and cleanse me and wash me of sin, and he freely justified me without me paying a dime, without me having to do a thing to earn it, without anything having to offer, without me having anything to bring to the table. Jesus Christ freely justified me without cost, without charge. Freely he did that. You see, the Bible mentions that several places freely. And like I said, I'm not going to give all of it, but I was amazed a while back when I did that word study on that. Let me just give you a couple of the other examples. Revelation 21:6 says, I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. Revelation 22:17 says, whoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Why does God keep putting that word in there freely? Because he wants us to understand something. It's not something we earn, it's something we receive. When somebody gives us something freely, when somebody gives us something as a gift, we don't do anything to earn it, we simply receive it. And that's what he's talking about here. All the blessings of God, we don't earn, we receive. So we've got to get that mentality where we're not always trying to strive and achieve and do something. You know, and the Bible tells us that we can confess our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive us of all of them and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And I thought, you know, just like that day when I was 25, when I went to the cross, so to speak, and received my salvation freely, I don't know about you guys, but there's been a lot of times I've gone back. There's been a lot of times I've had to go back to the cross. And every time I've went back to the cross, I freely received something. Every time I have had a need to go back and ask God to forgive me, sir, for something, I've freely received forgiveness. Every time I've had to go and ask him for healing, I've freely received healing. Every time I've had to need a financial provision and went to them to ask for it, I've freely received that. Every time I just need the touch of the Holy Spirit to strengthen me, I've freely received that. Every time I went to the cross, I freely received something. And not one time have I ever earned anything from God. Not one. Am I living? There's never been a charge. There's never been a hidden agenda. Now, go to Matthew chapter 2. Now, this is interesting. Can you see me, Gina?
Yeah.
Matthew chapter 10. And I'm just giving this kind of a short little teaching, and I should just kind of be a word of encouragement for you. That God hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus had called his 12 disciples to him and given them a commission and told them what they were to do. They were to go out and they were to heal the sick. They were to cast out devils. They were to raise the dead. A little bit later, we see that he commissioned 70 others to go out and heal the sick and cast out devils. A little bit later, in Mark chapter 16, he commissions the church to go out and preach the gospel, heal the sick, cast out devils. Why would he do that? Upon what basis would we have to go and lay hands on the sick? Upon what basis would we have to go out and cast out devils? What basis would we have to go for and expect God to do something because we're there and we're praying for somebody? Why should we do that? That word freely is going to come up again. Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Heal the sick, he's talking to the 12 apostles here. Cleanse the lepers. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. Why should we do that and how can we do that? Freely you have received. There's that freely again. You see, I mean, you'd be amazed if you did a word study how often the Word of God brings up that fact that we freely have received. So Jesus is telling you, you go heal the sick, you go cast out devils, you go cleanse the lepers, you go raise the dead. Why are we supposed to do that, Jesus? And how can we do that? Because you freely received. So since you freely received, you freely give. But first you have to understand, freely you've received. Freely you have received. Why could I expect to lay hands on a sick person and pray for them and then be healed? Because Christ has done the work. He has paid the price for the healing. Correct? Why would you pray for anybody and expect to see an answer? Because Jesus has already done the work. Freely we receive, freely we give. But beloved, first I think we have to understand the freely we have received. It's hard to give something that you don't understand you have. If all the church is in a place, beloved, where they're trying to earn things from God and achieve things from God, and one of these days I'm going to get there, and one of these days I'm going to reach that point, they're not going to be out there freely giving because they don't know they freely received anything. Why would somebody who's trying to live in a way to earn from God and don't know whether they have any kind of status with God, don't know how many God stamps they got, go out and try to pray for somebody to be healed? But once they realize, hey, freely I receive because of what Jesus Christ has done, Christ has paid the price for that healing, Christ has commissioned me to do it, then I can expect to pray for that person and then be healed. But first I have to have an understanding, first I have to have a revelation, freely I have received. How can I pray for you if I don't know I've received something? Oh, I don't know if God will answer my prayers, I ain't been good this week. Freely, you have received. So freely, you give. You have to understand what you received in Christ
before you give what you have received.
Amen? I mean, if you didn't know it, and I put $100 in your back seat tonight, and somebody came up to you and said, you know, can I borrow 20 bucks? You said, I don't got any money. But you got $100 in your car you don't know about. You freely received $100, but you're not aware of it. So you tell a person, I have nothing to give. So it's the same way God comes to you and says, I mean, somebody comes to you and says, will you pray for me? Well, I don't know that I've got anything to, I've never received anything from God. Freely you have received. Freely you give. Once I understand what I've received in Christ, once I understand who I am in Christ, once I understand what I have in Christ, once I understand I freely received it in Christ, once I understand I freely received all spiritual blessings, then I'm in a position to go give. Acts chapter 3. Freely you have received. Acts chapter 3, verse number 6. Let me show you another example of this. This is the example where Peter and John are going to pray. Most of us are familiar with this account in Acts chapter 3. And along the way, there's the man in a bugle begging alms. And Peter says something to him. Silver and gold have I not. Do I know what the next line is? But what I have. In other words, he understands what he has. Before he understands here what he has, but what I have, give I unto thee. In other words, there has been an understanding, there's been a revelation of something. He understands what he has. So he's in a position to minister and a position to give. So you see, when I'm talking about these things, that we've been blessed with all spiritual blessing, when I'm talking about how in Christ he's freely given us all things, and we can go to God and ask for all things, when I'm understanding this foundation that I'm laying here to understand that we've received freely from God, and we have all those unsearchable riches of Christ, is to understand so we can go and give it. You can't minister if you don't know you have it. If you don't understand what you have in the authority in the name of Jesus, as Peter and John did, silver and gold I have I none, but what I have I give unto thee, rise up and walk in the name of Jesus. If he didn't understand he had authority to tell that lame man to walk, then he would never say that, would he? Wait a second, we're getting ready to go to prayer. We're going to go pray through. After we pray for a while, then we'll come back and pray for you. We've got to go in there and pray for 6 hours before we have anything to give to you. But what I have. You see, beloved, we have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. The shed blood of Jesus Christ has already purchased them. We don't have to earn them. We have to receive them. That's why everything it talks about in the Bible is by faith. Because why would we do anything else? Because it's already been given to us. So all we have to do is believe that and receive that and walk in it. You have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. Freely you have received. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to earn it. It's not by the sweat of the brow. It's simply by believing God. Amen? Amen. Let Dina come to the keyboard for a moment.